Let's talk about what total strain means and what calculations look like involving total strain, including chair conformations. So total strain, as we define it as just strain total here, is equal of the sum of its parts. So we could say it's the sum of strain due to angles. So like if we have a cyclopropane or butane or pentane, or any other size ring except cyclohexane, a 14-membered ring, are strain-free, we have to be given a table of values that give us these total strain amounts for angle strain. And so 6 and 14 being strain-free. So angle strain is a component. And then we also have torsional strain, which is due to eclipsing interactions, say with a Newman projection, dihedral angles that are non-ideal, okay, so less than 60 degrees, where we have overlapping eclipsing, that's torsional strain. And then we also have steric strain, which can be one of a couple of things early in our course. The first being a Gauche type strain. So if we have a staggered conformation of an ethane type molecule or any linear alkane, where we have groups such as a methyl that are near each other, that are 60 degrees apart in dihedral angle, we have bumping that occurs between these groups that we will call Gauche strain. And it's a long distance interaction, so it's a form of steric strain. Bumping between eclipsing interactions, torsional strain is right next door. Okay, 0 degree dihedral angle. Then we have long distance interaction bumping for Gauche strain. We can also have, in the case of a cyclohexane, we can have 1-3 diaxial interactions, which I'm going to call AX here, so axial strain, diaxial strain, where we have groups that are axial, such as this methyl group, can interact 3 carbons apart. So this is 1-3 diaxial, because it happens 1-2-3 positions away, and you always get 2 at a time when you have a big group in the axial position. Okay, so we're going to have a couple of components of steric strain, but the sum is all the different parts added together with an alternate way of defining total strain is we can say that total strain is equal to the difference between the actual heat of formation of a compound minus the predicted heat of formation using a calculation based on strain-free molecules. So this difference between what we predict, and it's an absolute value here because it's always greater. So we could say the other way around, the actual minus the predicted should be positive, but it is absolute value. But the total strain left over from what we would predict is strain-free. So we should end up with a number greater than 0. But we can always get it if we just assume that it's always positive. Okay, so that's two ways to define strain. Let's look at an example where we put together the total strain of 2 conformations of cyclohexane, a trisubstituted cyclohexane. So we have a couple of questions. Is calculate total strain. And then which one is less strain? Is more stable. Okay, so we need to be able to identify all the parts of strain here. So if we put all our parts of strain in a kind of a column here, we've got angle, we've got torsional, we've got steric, so we can have, with steric, we can have Gauche strain, Gauche interaction, and we can have diaxial interactions for steric strain. Okay, so if we look at our compounds, cyclohexane means we're not going to have angle strain for either one of these. The chair conformation exists in the way that it does because it achieves 109.5 bond angles and creates anti-conformations or staggered conformations for every bond in the molecule, so we eliminate angle and torsional. So what we're looking for, Gauche strain and 1,3 diaxial strain, as the ring flips from one ring flip to the other. Okay, so what we've got to do is we've got to define our positions. So if we number this thing, we would end up putting the lowest number by going 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so we can lower the numbers on our groups by going 1, 2, 3, 4. So as we would name it in nomenclature, those are our 1, 2, 3, and 4 carbons. So we've got to turn around here and label 1, 2, 3, and 4 on our template somewhere. And I like to put carbon 1 at one end or the other, at one corner, so either here or here, and we'll go top left here just for fun. And we have to number around clockwise here because that's the way it's drawn out in our skeletal structure preview here. So we've got to go carbon 1, carbon 2, 3, and 4. And we do the same thing after the ring flip, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay, so that happens here as well. So we got to be consistent for both the ring flipped up and the ring flipped down on one side. Then we define our axial position. So the corner that's pointed up is always axial up. And then the corner pointed down is always axial down. And then axial position alternates at every carbon. So we'll just draw the ones that matter here. Just the ones we have groups attached to in our final molecule. So we have now axial down, axial up, and down, and then back up again. Okay, so everything else is equatorial. We want to make those as close to possible, being parallel to the bond, two away, two to the side. And so as we do these, and so we've defined our axial positions first so that we can define our equatorial positions, and axial up means we have equatorial down. Okay, so anytime axial's down, then we'd have equatorial up and so forth. So that's important when we're translating our structure. And so at carbon 1, we have methyl up at us with the wedge, so I want to put the methyl here up in the axial position. Likewise, chlorine is up on the skeletal structure. I want to put it equatorial up at carbon 2. And then 3, 4, we are down relative to the ring at carbon 4, so I want to put the final methyl down as we are on our structure. So we've got carbons 1, 2, 3, and 4 defined here in the correct orientation for our structure. So anything left over that's not shown is a hydrogen, so we draw those in. And then we ring flip, and so we go from axial up to equatorial up. But we stay in the same relative positions relative to our original structure. And then equatorial down becomes axial down. Likewise, the chlorine becomes axial up. And then at carbon 4, we become equatorial down as we were axial down. Okay, so we've got our two conformations successfully drawn out here. And so now we've got to determine the other types of strain that we have. So if we're looking for Gauche strain, then what we have to do is look for carbons that are side by side. So as we make a Newman projection and we circle a bond, make the Newman projection, the bonds on the Newman have to be at neighboring carbons. And so carbon 4, which is down here, is not going to participate in any type of Gauche interaction. So really it's carbon 1 and 2. So as we define that here, we would have to look at the 1-2 bond and see if we have a Gauche interaction. So I'm going to draw a Newman projection with axial up for carbon 1. Axial up is methyl. There it is. Then the back carbon, axial down, is a hydrogen. And so I'm going to put that there to find the staggered Newman projection. The ring connects to itself on the right-hand side. And then we have an equatorial chlorine on carbon 2. Okay, there it is on the back carbon. And so we fill in all the structures. So we do indeed have a methyl to chlorine Gauche interaction in the structure on the left. In the structure on the right, the 1-2 bond is here after the ring flip. We can draw it in as well. So carbon 1, we have axial down now, so I'll draw it upside down from the way we did before. Put the hydrogen axial down. In the back carbon, carbon 2, we have a chlorine that's axial up. The ring connects off to the right. And then we have on carbon 1, the front, we have the methyl. And then in the back carbon, we have a hydrogen. So what I've got here is another Gauche interaction, methyl to chlorine, that we have to account for in this structure. So then, now that we've got our Gauche interactions taken care of, we look at 1,3 diaxial strain. So as I see, I'm going to erase this so we can see a little better. Okay, so as I see on the structure on the left, I have got a methyl axial here, I've got a methyl axial here. So I've got to look at my other axial positions. Here are the other two axial ups. We have a methyl interacting with those above the ring. So here are the ups, they're above the ring. Hydrogen's too small to interact with itself, so we have nothing here. Okay, so methyl to hydrogen, we have two of those on the bottom. We also have axial down hydrogens that we have to account for below the ring that are interacting with the axial methyl below the ring. So we end up with 4 methyl to hydrogen 1,3 diaxial strain interactions. On the right-hand conformer, we have methyls that are in the equatorial, so we're good there, but we do have a chlorine that's axial, so we have to account for it. Find all the axial up, since chlorine's axial up. Chlorine to hydrogen, chlorine to hydrogen. So we have 2 chlorine to hydrogen 1,3 diaxial interactions. So the total strain then is the sum of these, and so we end up with 1 methyl to chlorine, 4 methyl to hydrogen diaxial, so 1 methyl to chlorine Gauche, 4 methyl to hydrogen diaxials, the same methyl to chlorine Gauche, and then 2 chlorine to hydrogen diaxials. When you add these up from a table, you would end up getting that this is a higher number of kilojoules per mole than the structure on the right. So it turns out that the structure on the right is lower energy, less strain, and thus more stable. And because it's more stable, a more negative delta G or lower delta G, that means its equilibrium constant's going to be bigger, which means it exists more of the time. It has a higher equilibrium constant than the conformer on the left because it's more stable.